pivotal point where like no one else was there.
Yes. So we came to Standing Rock on Labor Day weekend, mm-hmm. and we were covering whatever was happening, interviewing people throughout the camps. And as we came back from the Sacred Stone camp on Saturday, and we're just moving into the main camp, there were all sorts of ceremonies going on. This is really at the height of what was happening. Thousands of people were coming to the camp. We heard that there was another ceremony just down the road that people were planting their tribal flags. Well, we thought, should we cover the horses coming in here at the main camp or cover that ceremony? So many ceremonies were taking place. But we thought, we'll go cover that because I think the horses were going to be a little later in the day. And we went up the road, and you see those flags there. And we went up and we saw a gathering of people. And so we just had our cameras running. And then we saw the bulldozers. Really, it was right about the time the people were all seeing what was happening. They did not expect this. They were very surprised also. I think because it was Labor Day weekend, they did not think the Dakota Access Pipeline would be excavating. So they were shocked. At first they were praying, then they started saying, no, stop excavating the site, and it went on from there.
I wonder, you know, the initial charge against you was this trespass charge, and how do you see your role, you know, in a situation where people are, you know, maybe doing something that's at least technically illegal, you know, what's your job? Just, you know, follow them in, or do you have like a certain code that you follow when it comes to things like that?
You know, I think on the issue of criminal trespass, that clearly the state's attorney, the prosecutor here, decided he did not have grounds for that charge. Although he originally brought the charge as we flew in this past Friday, just as we were landing, we learned he dropped the charge, that he didn't have evidence for it. But then to show that he was really efficient, that he then came up with another charge. This is not the original charge. And I also want to point something else out. We broadcast that report that night and over the next few days, and all the networks picked it up, you know, on Facebook, it was all picked up. It wasn't for 5 days, the day, Thursday, that the governor pulled out the National Guard. Until September 8th, the day the governor called out the National Guard, that they issued this arrest warrant for me. I think that was a clear message. Don't come back to North Dakota. You know, it's a very heightened point.
Is there something blocking it? What's going on? Sorry, guys.
We're in trouble because we have to get to the airport. Yeah. I think they wanted me to not come back, but no, we came back when we could to fight the charges. I mean, it was very serious because it means wherever I am, I can be arrested and I could be extradited to North Dakota. But we decided to come back this Friday to fight the charges, and I mean, to show how frivolous they were, as he dropped them once I was here, and came up with this other charge, this very vague charge of riot. This is clearly meant to intimidate, and I think the judge saw that clearly today, just did not find merit in these charges and refused to sign off on them. I can't stress enough how important the First Amendment is at every level. How important it is for reporters to be able to do their job, because it's important for the public to know what's going on.
What was the effect, like, personally, you know, on both the charges and then the prosecutor telling me that he thought you, you know, were kind of just an advocate and were one of the protesters?
I mean, the criminal complaint for the criminal trespass charge was, you know, really said it all. The investigator quoted in that criminal complaint said, Amy Goodman identifies herself and she can be seen interviewing protesters. That's exactly what I was doing, interviewing protesters. And I think that's exactly what the state's attorney, what the prosecutor didn't want. We are covering this epic battle, and we see it in other places, but right now it's here in North Dakota, where you have Native Americans, hundreds of tribes from Latin America, Canada, and the United States, in the largest unification that we've seen in decades, gathering together along with non-Native allies and taking on this pipeline. It is a critical juncture in the history of the planet when we are seeing the massive effects of climate change and global warming. You know, we just came out of Hurricane Matthew. 1,000 people are dead in Haiti. Scores of people drowned in the southeast of the died, and also a number drowned in the southeast of the United States. And that's what this struggle is about here in North Dakota. It's how we're all connected. And, you know, we covered the battle over the Keystone XL. This is only 6 miles shorter than the Keystone XL, the Dakota Access Pipeline. And what's amazing about what's happening here is you have Bismarck rejected the Dakota Access Pipeline to be near Bismarck and Mandan. Both cities said no. And it ends up on Native American land. That's what so horrifies the people of Standing Rock. Why, when city after city says no, are they stuck with this pipeline? And what's so interesting about what people are saying there is they don't see it as just their own struggle. They will often even reach out to the police. We covered a march on Saturday, really a ceremony.
Yeah, it was
very peaceful
down there.
And, you know, you had over 100 people who marched. They started with a water ceremony, and they offered water to the police. Mm-hmm. And they said, it's for you, too. This isn't only our struggle. They talk about the 10 million people that rely on the Missouri River for water. And they say this is for everyone. We're also seeing, as we did in Ferguson and other places, and at Occupy, the whole movement that began 5 years ago, this militarization of local police. I mean, just at this peaceful march on Saturday, you had over 100 heavily militarized police with an MRAP behind them. You don't know if you're in a war zone or if you're in a back road of North Dakota. And all of these issues are playing out all over the country. Now, Democracy Now! Covers movements because movements make history. And it's so important that we, you know, really simply follow the tenets of good journalism. We are the fourth estate. We are not for the state. We are providing a forum for people to speak for themselves and have debate and dialogue with many others. And this is how public policy gets made, how the fate of the planet is determined. You know, people say journalism is the first draft of history. Well, it should include everyone, not just the presidents and the generals and the high-level elected officials, but people on the ground who make history every day.
I have a couple more really quick ones for you. So after your report, you know, or at the same time, you know, the Morton County Sheriff came out with this kind of diametrically opposed report. And I just wonder, you know, what do you make of the things that they said happened, you know, about guards being beat up or things like that? You know, we saw two totally different versions. And I was like,
you know, when we were flying out on Sunday, mm-hmm. we read the Bismarck Tribune and were astonished because it was, and I know that the editor has apologized and said, you know, there wasn't anyone in the newsroom really who was there, and they just got a report from the sheriff's office and the security. But it's so important to broaden that. I mean, the sheriff wasn't there either. And so really, all these reports came down to what the security guard said. And I hesitate even to call them security, because that's hardly what they were doing. I dare say there were people there, employed by the pipeline, who were horrified by what they saw, by the other security who had dogs. I don't think this had been seen before. It's very serious. It seems as if the pipeline company knew there was going to be trouble on a holiday weekend at the point where the tribe had just given over the map of their sacred sites to the judge, right, and then had given that map, ultimately, to the pipeline company.
Are you relieved now that this is over, or what?
I'm deeply relieved, but it's just strengthened my resolve that we have to fight to ensure that the First Amendment is protected. All journalists must stand together, but it's not just for journalists. It's for everyone, because freedom of the press means that there is